Hello, welcome to the self-learning podcast by Dr. Sushma Singh. Let us start discussion on Unit 12, Power or Knowledge. Sociologists usually define power as the ability to impose one's will on others, even if those others resist in some way. By power, it is meant that opportunity existing within a social relationship which permits one to carry out one's will even against resistance and regardless of the basis on which this opportunity rests. Power manifests itself in a relational manner. That is, one cannot meaningfully say that a particular social actor has power without also specifying the other parties to the social relationship. Also, power almost always operates reciprocally, but usually not equally reciprocally. The understanding and analysis of power has been critical to sociological thought. One of the prominent delineation of power has been provided by the Michael Foucault. His works analyze the link between the power and the knowledge. Foucault began his intellectual pursuits in philosophy, but became disillusioned by its abstractions and naive truth claims, and turned to the psychology and physiopathology. This resulted in his early writings, Madness and Civilization, The Birth of Clinic, and the initiated his lifelong interest in the relationship between the power and knowledge. The main influences on Foucault's thought were German philosophers Friedrich Nietzsche and Martin Heidegger. Nietzsche contended that the truth, knowledge and power are inextricably associated. He maintained that human behavior is motivated by a will to power, and that traditional values had lost their power over society. Heidegger criticized what he called our current technological understanding of being. Foucault's thought explored the shifting pattern of power within a society and the ways in which power relates to the self. He investigated the changing rules governing the kind of claims that could be taken seriously as true or false at different times in history. He also studied how everyone practices enabled people to define their identities and systematize knowledge. Events may be understood as being produced by nature, by human effort, or by God. Foucault argued that each way of understanding things had its advantages and its dangers. Now let us move to the point definition of power. Foucault never attempts at any definition of power but gives a definition of power relations at best. The exercise of power is not simply a relationship between partners, individuals or collective. It is a way in which certain actions modify others, which is to say, of course, that something called power with or without a capital letter, which is assumed to exist universally in a concentrated or diffused form, does not exist. Foucault goes on to insist that the knowledge and power are always and necessarily interdependent. a site where power is enforced is also a site where knowledge is produced, and conversely, a site from which knowledge is derived is a place where power is exercised. In Discipline and Punish, he sees prison as an example of just such a site of power, and as a place where knowledge essential to the modern social sciences was formed. Reciprocally, the ideas from which the social sciences were formulated were also the ones that gave birth to the prison. The belief that a scientist can arrive at an objective conclusion, Foucault argues, is one of the greatest fallacies of the modern humanist era. Modern humanism is therefore mistaken in drawing this line between the knowledge and power. Knowledge and power are integrated with one another, and there is no point in dreaming of a time where knowledge will cease to depend on power. This is just a way of reviving humanism in a utopian guise. It is not possible for power be exercised without knowledge. It is impossible for knowledge not to endanger power. So, instead of referring to power and knowledge separately, he preferred to compound the term power and knowledge. This is especially pertinent to scientific discourses, which are legitimated by the rationality paradigm. Discourses contain power because they establish particular truths and knowledge, and their power is exercised through the creation and sustenance of social norms, practices and institutions. In Foucaultian analysis, power is not monopolized by any one subject through its control of the predominant discourse. The discursive field comprises multiple subjects who manipulate various discourses to some extent. For Foucault, the issue is not origin of discourses, but the implications of their power, effects, and the types of knowledge they produce and institutionalize. Since power originates in discourses, it has no unitary source, but is heterogeneous and pluralistic, coming from everywhere and being everywhere. Now let us move to the next point, power, knowledge and discourse. Foucault analyzes the relationship between the power, knowledge and discourse that develops from the establishment of Enlightenment rationality, which presents itself as progressive and emancipatory. The hegemony of the Enlightenment rationality and its institutions and the marginalization of other discourses create and validate a social network of normative power, which disciplines and constrains the individual at the micro level. Foucault studies the emergence of several kinds of rationalities in history. The emergence of a particular kind of rationality then presupposes that the field of knowledge is tightly linked with an empirical field. Due to its instrumentality, a form of reason as well as any form of knowledge define a set of possible practices and is thus an instrument of power. Further, being embodied in an empirical field, a form of reason for or any form of knowledge supported by it has no being beyond any set of practices. Therefore, the field of knowledge defines a field of power and vice versa. Power thus is not to be considered as opposite to reason, but on the contrary, as the necessary condition for the construction of knowledge. Moreover, because power produces knowledge, it can be at least partially grasped or anarchology. Foucault's discussion of the nature of modern power is located within the postmodern framework. In keeping with the postmodern perspective, he critiques modernity and the universal claim of modern rationality and emphasizes multiplicity, discontinuity, and fragmentation. Foucault calls for a theoretical production which is independent, localized, and free from traditional discourse, such as his own application of the differing but overlapping perspective of psychology, medicine, criminology, sexuality, and his exploration of modernity. The two major approaches employed by Foucault in his analysis of power and knowledge were archaeology and genealogy. His aim is to establish a genealogy of how power is exercised in our own society, basing his analysis on archaeology of the discursive formations. Hence, his analysis is aimed toward the modes of functioning of power in our society. Now, let us wind up the session and take rest. Thank you very much for engaging yourself with the self-learning podcast.